Listening Library presents Who is George Lucas? By Pam Pollack and Meg Belviso. Read for you by Marc Cashman. Who is George Lucas? In 1977, film director George Lucas invited some friends to his house in San Anselmo, California. He promised to show them an early, unfinished version of the new movie he was making. George had been working on Star Wars for 18 hours a day for over a year. George settled everyone in front of the screen, where they watched Luke Skywalker battling Darth Vader in the dreaded Death Star. They met the droids R2-D2 and C-3PO. They learned about the Force, the mystical power that Jedi space knights used to control the world around them. When the movie finished, everyone was thinking the same thing. It was a disaster. After the screening, one friend wasn't afraid to tell George what he really thought. Brian De Palma, another young director, teased him relentlessly about the almighty Force and the questionable wardrobe choices. "Hey, George, what were those Danish rolls doing in the princess's ears?" he asked about Princess Leia's soon-to-be-famous hairstyle. Even worse than De Palma's teasing was the pity expressed by George's other friends. Always shy and quiet, George simply listened to the criticism. Steven Spielberg thought the movie was good, but George had already accepted that it was a failure. "I figured, well, it's just a silly movie," he said later. "It ain't going to work." After the screening, Alan Ladd Jr., the studio executive who had given George the money to make Star Wars, called Spielberg and asked him what he really thought of the movie. "I think this film is going to make $100 million, Spielberg said. "People will love it." Spielberg was right. People loved Star Wars. What he didn't know was that Star Wars would become much more than a hit movie. It would forever change the way movies were made. Chapter 1. Ramona Avenue. On May 14, 1944, George Walton Lucas Jr. was born in Modesto, California. His father, George Sr., and his mother, Dorothy, already had two daughters, Anne and Katie. When George was three, his younger sister, Wendy, was born into the growing family on Ramona Avenue. As a young boy, George often ran errands for his father's stationery store after school. But he wasn't interested in greeting cards and writing paper. What George loved was listening to radio shows and picturing everything in his mind. He loved comic books like Scrooge McDuck and pulp magazines like Amazing Stories. When the family got their first television, George was 10. He devoured new shows like Have Gun, Will Travel and Gunsmoke. He also watched old serials on TV. Serials were short movies that always ended on a cliffhanger with the hero in danger. George loved wondering what would happen next. To George, the stories in his head were more interesting than the things he was studying in school, and his grade showed it. His father wasn't happy with his report cards, but George's imagination was too big to control. He was always making plans. With the help of his sister Wendy and his best friends, John Plummer and George Frankenstein, he organized a backyard carnival with rides and games, a homemade funhouse, and a zoo filled with all the pets in the neighborhood. At the center of the carnival was a roller coaster that George designed. It rolled down an incline, rotated on a turntable made out of a huge telephone wire spool, and rolled onto the ground. George also liked building environments, tiny worlds, cities, and farms made of dirt, berries, and cement poured into carefully made molds. When George had an idea, it could be amazing. When George was 11, his family traveled to Anaheim, California, for the opening of Disneyland. Disneyland was like one of George's environments on a grand scale, a whole world built from the imagination of one man, Walt Disney. George Sr. thought practical things like earning money were more important than imagination. All the Lucas children worked hard for a weekly allowance. One of George's chores was mowing the lawn with a manual mower. He was so small, he couldn't do it well. If only they had an electric lawnmower, he could do his chores more quickly and efficiently. But electric lawnmowers were expensive. For 4 months, George saved every penny of his allowance. That gave him $35, still not enough for a lawnmower. He borrowed another $25 from his mother and bought a power mower for $60. George Sr. was furious that George didn't ask permission. But as he watched the boy cutting the grass more smoothly than he ever had before, he felt a strange kind of pride. George was stubborn. He did things the way he wanted to do them. But his father couldn't deny that the lawnmower was a smart idea. In his own way, his imaginative son was also a good businessman. Chapter 2. Cruising. When George was 15, his family moved from Ramona Avenue to a walnut ranch on the outskirts of Modesto. There was plenty of room for George to pursue his new passions. The first was music. When school was over, rather than doing his homework, George locked himself in his room, listening to rock and roll, drinking Coca-Cola, and eating Hershey bars. The birth of rock and roll. Rock and roll was born out of the traditions of country music, rhythm and blues, and gospel music. After World War II, with the growing availability and mass production of record players, electric guitars, and transistor radios, songs like Rock Around the Clock by Bill Haley and the Comets, That's All Right by Elvis Presley, and Maybelline by Chuck Berry gained popularity. The rock and roll sound had a driving beat and a fast tempo that kids loved and parents hated. More than just a style of music, rock and roll became a look and an attitude, influencing fashion and language. It was exciting, rebellious, and wild. George's father bought him a 35mm camera and helped him convert the family spare bathroom into a dark room to develop pictures. Whenever George heard a crop plane flying overhead, he ran outside to take pictures of it. When he was 14, George became fascinated with motorcycles. A year later, his focus shifted to cars. He was still too young to have a license, but he often drove around the ranch for fun. He hung out in auto repair shops, looking under the hoods of cars. At 16, George failed his driver's test because he didn't follow the rules of the road. He eventually got his license, but he still wasn't good at following the rules. George Sr. also got George his own car, a Fiat. It wasn't the kind of car George had in mind. It had a sewing machine motor in it, he said. It was a dumb little car. What could I do with that? It was practically a motor scooter. George made plans to turn the Fiat into a racing car. George's parents were getting worried. His grades were terrible. He looked like a JD, juvenile delinquent. Nice boys in the late 1950s wore chinos and sweaters and cut their hair short. George grew his hair past his ears and slicked it back with Vaseline. He wore dirty jeans and white t-shirts. George was becoming a greaser, so named for all the grease they wore in their hair. George and his friends drove up and down the streets of Modesto looking for girls and listening to rock and roll. George's favorite radio DJ was Wolfman Jack, the outlaw of the airwaves, who broadcasts late at night from a Mexican radio station. No one knew the real identity of the Wolfman, but George came to think of him as a friend. George and his friends called what they did at night cruising. They drove the same circuit over and over, around 10th and 11th streets. On the way, they talked to kids in other cars and switched passengers. It was a giant party on the road every night. Occasionally, they raced each other. In the afternoons, George beefed up the engine of his Fiat at the local garage. The car was getting faster. George loved taking corners at top speed, enjoying the feel of being almost out of control. One afternoon, he skidded and rolled the car over. It didn't slow George down. He just cut off the dented roof and replaced it with a roll bar, a tubular bar meant to protect passengers if the car flipped over. George longed to be a race car driver. He couldn't enter Formula One races until he was 21, but he won a lot of trophies in autocrosses, competitions held in parking lots. He joined a sports car competition club and edited its newsletter.
George's boyhood. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.